Test, test. Good afternoon. Good Friday's liturgy commemorates the passion and death of Jesus. This service is one of deep sorrow, yet one of quiet joy. For we know as Christians that the events commemorated today are not the end, but that the events of today lead into the glory of tomorrow evening's Easter Vigil and the proclamation of the resurrection.
Good Friday's liturgy.
However, today's liturgy is very stark and solemn. Let us pause for silent prayer and reflection upon the events and meaning of today's liturgy.
O God, who by the passion of Christ, your Son, our Lord, abolished the death inherited from ancient sin by every succeeding generation, grant that just as being conformed to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of man on earth, so by the sanctification of grace, we may hear the image of man, we may bear the image of man of heaven. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. We now hear three readings telling of the events of Jesus' suffering and death and of the meaning they should have for us. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond that of a man, and his appearance beyond that of mortals. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, no appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by men, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity. One of those from whom men hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away, and who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
But as for me, I still try. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
Let your face shine on your servant. Monte, take courage in the Lord.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. We have a great high priest who passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our profession of faith. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who is tempted in every way that we are, yet never sinned. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and favor and to find help in time of need. In the days when he was in the flesh, Christ offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to God, who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when perfected, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
I am.
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, I am, they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
Whom are you looking for?
They said,
Jesus the Nazarene.
Jesus answered,
I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go.
This was to fulfill what he had said, I have not lost any of those you gave me. Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drain the cup the Father gave me?
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guard seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter,
You're not one of this man's disciples, are you?
He said,
I am not.
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made, because it was cold, and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gathered, and in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
Is this the way you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered him,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, to the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
You're not one of his disciples, are you?
He denied it and said,
I am not.
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
Didn't I see you in the garden with him?
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
What charge do you bring against this man?
They answered and said to him,
If he were not a criminal, we would not have to hand him over to you.
At this, Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law.
The Jews answered him,
We do not have the right to execute anyone.
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die, so Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
Then you are a king.
Jesus answered,
You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?
They cried out again,
Not this one, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the Jews.
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I'm bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and he said to them,
Behold the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him, so Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you, and I have the power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You have no power over me. If it had not been given to you from above, for this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar.
Now when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement. In Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was noon. And he said to the Jews,
Behold your king.
They cried out,
Take him away, take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, on one on either side with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be.
In order that the passage of the scripture might be fulfilled that says, they divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and his disciple, there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now fulfilled, in order that the scriptures might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit.
I invite those who can to please kneel. Please stand.
Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus. And Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This Good Friday, on the hill of Calvary, Jesus drinks the cup of his passion of death. He goes to the darkest moment of his life. The seven last words of Jesus can teach us how to go through the dark moments of our lives, just like the one we are in now, in this pandemic. The first words of Jesus, "Father, forgive them, for for they know not what they do. Sometimes because others have hurt us, we carry the burden of grudge, resentment, hatred, or revenge. Jesus is telling us to let go, to forgive with God's help. Only then can we truly be free. Only then can the cycle of sin, hatred, and violence stop. These words of Jesus also tell us that He is our intercessor who pleads for God's mercy for us. During this time, Jesus is saying, forgive, and also ask for forgiveness. The second words of Jesus, this day you will be with me in paradise. Like the good thief, these words remind us that no matter what our past has been, we can begin anew. God's mercy is way greater than our worst sin. May we use this time to renew our relationship with God. Like the good thief, may we stay on the cross with Jesus and echo His prayer, especially during this time of the pandemic. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. The third words of Jesus, there is your mother, there your son. Jesus has entrusted His mother to us. May we never hesitate to ask Mary, our mother, to pray and intercede for us before her son, as she did at the wedding of Cana. The fourth words of Jesus, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus felt the pain and agony of God's absence, an experience of one who does not have God in his or her life. Jesus is telling us that no matter how bleak or dark our situation may seem, we can always call and cry out to God. When God seems absent or distant, He is actually right there in the midst of our darkness and suffering. God is right here with us during this time of the pandemic. The fifth words of Jesus, I thirst. Christ is thirsting for our love, thirsting for our trust, our peace, joy, and salvation. May we quench the thirst of Christ by growing deeper in our love and devotion to Him, who is present in the Eucharist, in the sacraments, in our church community, and in each other, especially in those who suffer and in the poor. The six words of Jesus, it is finished. Reuben, our musician, just texted me what the meaning of this in Greek. The Greek word for it is finished is tetelestai, a term used to cancel business debts. This word is written on receipts and documents indicating that the debt is paid in full. My brothers and sisters, Jesus accepted the bill for us and paid a great price for this bill. Because as we know, the wages of sin is death, death to our soul. But the gift that Christ has won for us is new life in God, eternal life. What is finished, we ask? What is finished is the work of the Father, the Son's mission to save us, to destroy sin and death, to open the gates of heaven, to restore God's image and likeness in us. Jesus has paved the way to the Father for us, to get home safely to the Father, to finish our own mission here on earth. May we follow Christ faithfully as our way, our truth, and our life. Lastly, the seventh words of Jesus. The seventh words of Jesus, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. These last words of Jesus tell us that he came from the Father and is now returning home. The same is true for us. Our lives belong to God. He is the Alpha and Omega of our lives. Our daily call is to learn to entrust our lives into his hands, to surrender our will to his will, to share our God-given gifts and blessings with others. These words of Jesus is also comforting for us, especially since we have experienced so much death in our own parish, in our own city, our own country, and in our world. The whole world is mourning because of so much death. But we are reminded that our true home is in God, in heaven. For our loved ones who have passed on, we entrust them the loving mercy of God, and we pray that they have reached our true home in heaven. For us, when our journey is over, may our spirit return to its right home, to its rightful place, God's home. My brothers and sisters, may these seven last words of Jesus guide us and bring us peace and strength in our hearts as we navigate and go through the storms and dark moments of our lives.
Having heard the story of how Jesus won for all people grace, prayer, and life by giving himself up to death, we now turn in prayer to God and set before him the needs of the whole world. After each intention, you are asked to pray for a moment of silence. If you're able to kneel, you may, as directed. After each of the concluding prayers, you are asked to respond with Amen. And if you're kneeling, then we can stand for the next intention.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Almighty Father. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, who in Christ revealed your glory to all nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout the whole world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please stand. Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord may choose him, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness, protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him, the Christian people governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our Bishop Jose Gomez, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our elect, especially for Ava, Jocelyn, and Tan, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our elect, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us also pray for our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth to gather them together and keep them in His one church. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain fullness of redemption We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, and that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us also pray for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, who created all people, to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love, and witness to the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God, and Father of our human race. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us also pray for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will for the true peace and freedom of all. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may, through your gift, be made secure. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that He may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, grant to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for all those who suffer the consequences of the current pandemic, that God the Father will grant health to the sick, strength to those who care for them, comfort to families, and salvation to all victims who have passed away. Please kneel. Almighty and ever-living Father, the only support of our human weakness, look with compassion on the sad condition of your children who suffer because of this pandemic, ease the pain of the sick, strengthen those who care for them, welcome those who have died into your peace, and in this time of trouble, may we all find comfort in your merciful love. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just like to again thank you for your continued generosity to our church. The collection for this celebration is for the Holy Land, for the Franciscans to maintain the shrines and the different charity works that they do in the Holy Land. Those who are participating in your homes, you could make a donation to this Holy Land collection through our website just by clicking the image link connected to the Holy Land collection.
The cross, the sign of our salvation, will now be carried in solemn procession into the procession here. It should not be seen just as an instrument of death, but also as a glorious symbol of resurrection and new life. For the cross is brought in today in the same way as tomorrow night, when we carry into the church the Easter candle, the symbol of the risen Lord. At the rear, when the presider holds up the cross and sings, "Behold the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world," let our response be, "Come, let us worship." Then in silence we kneel in veneration of their cross.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the Savior of the world.
Come, let us worship.
Please kneel. Please stand. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the Savior of the world.
Come, let us worship.
Please kneel. Please stand.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the Savior of the world.
Come, let us worship.
Please kneel. Please stand. Normally, if we are in the church, we will allow each one to venerate the cross individually. But because of this pandemic, we are doing the veneration in a different way. The veneration of the cross is an opportunity for us to renew our call, to embrace our cross as Jesus invited us. He said that if we are to be his disciples, we should be willing to take up our cross and follow him. So as you venerate the cross and kiss the cross that you have after we bless it, just make that renewal to embrace our crosses, not alone, but with him, to embrace it with patience, with hope, with peace in our hearts, knowing that Jesus is with us. So at this time, I invite all of you to just raise the cross that you have, and we're going to bless it. You could use this cross as your memento, as your souvenir of your participation in our Good Friday celebration. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing on these crosses, that those who use it may be reminded of the sacrifice that you embrace for us, in order to save us and redeem us of our sin. Bless them that they may faithfully carry their cross with you, with patience, with faith and hope, that through our crosses, salvation and blessing may also come. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. You may kiss the crosses that you have.
Continue with the service of Holy Communion. The joy of a full Eucharist is not in keeping with the solemnity of today, but the Church does not want Christians to be denied the body and blood of Christ on this day of all days. Therefore, the sacred hosts that were consecrated yesterday are used for this communion service.
At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we now dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, O Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our lives, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Behold, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Those of you watching in your homes, I invite you at this time to make your spiritual communion with our Lord. Just invite our Lord Jesus to come into your heart, mind, and soul. And just talk to him from your heart. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living Father, who have restored us to life, by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have life unceasingly devoted to you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I invite the Father Joseph to join me in blessing you. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May the abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come and comfort given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure through Christ our Lord. Amen. After the service, we invite you to spend time before Jesus in our patio of our shrine of Lavan. We have the holy, the image of the holy corpus of the crucified Christ for your veneration and prayer. So it's the statue of Christ laying down after being taken from the cross. So it's in our patio. You're welcome to pray before Jesus. Just park in the parish center and just walk to the patio using the carport of the rectory. And just maintain your distance, keep your mask, and if you use the chair, just please disinfect the chair after using it. We have the disinfection spray there as well as the paper towels. Again, thank you for celebrating with us this Good Friday celebration.
Thank you. Jesus, come on.